Okay. Good day to everyone. So this is going to be our last topic for the initial part of your financial management. So we'll be discussing capital budgeting decisions. Okay. So when you talk about capital budgeting decisions, basically we are talking about whether or not we are going to proceed with a particular project. Okay. And when you talk about a particular project, this is going to be a project that will require a big amount or a huge amount of money. That's why you need to make the correct decisions, okay, in order for you to recuperate your cost and at the same time also to earn a profit. Okay, so the objectives of our discussion will be as follows. So first will be to discuss the basic concept of capital budgeting decisions. Second is to understand cash flows and its relationship with capital budgeting. Third, discuss the methods of ranking investments using the three methods, which are payback methods, internal rate of return, and net present value. And then next will be concept of discount or cutoff rate. And then finally, we're going to discuss the after-tax operating benefits and tax shield benefit of depreciation. So those are basically the items that we're going to discuss. Okay, so let's start first with your capital budgeting decision. So when you talk about capital budgeting decisions, it involves the planning of your expenditures for a project that will take more than 1 year, okay, in order for you to determine whether you are going to pursue that particular project. Take note that these projects will be more than 1 year. So it could be on an average around 5 years, or it can be longer. That's why you need to make sure that you're going to make the right decisions, because it is not easily reversible. Meaning if you make a mistake in pursuing a project, you cannot simply end a project that was already started, because certain funds are already committed for that particular project. Okay, so capital expenditure decisions will require extensive planning and coordination of different departments, because basically all departments or all segments of your business will be affected. And uncertainties are also common in areas in capital budgeting, such as on the aspect of the annual cost and the inflows of the project, the product life of the products involved in the project, your interest rates, your economic conditions, and your technological changes. So those are all considerations that we're going to have in capital budgeting decisions. Also, we have administrative decisions, which administrative considerations, which we are going to consider in making a decision, which means that there is a process that we need to follow in order for us to make sound decisions for the business. So the steps in decision making will be as follows. First, we are going to look for certain investment opportunities. So we are going to look for projects, we are going to look for new avenues for investing our money, we're going to look for various alternatives where we can put our money so that we can earn a profit. So that's the first step. Second step is we're going to collect data in order for us to have an idea of the prospective profitabilities, liquidities, and all other areas relating to all the projects that are initially considered. Okay, so the data collection process will also involve the process of doing certain feasibility studies, okay, and all other items. Okay, and then afterwards we're going to evaluate the projects and then make decisions. Okay, so the evaluation of your project and the decision making will come after all data are gathered and analyzed, and there you are going to determine already whether you are going to pursue the project or not. And that's where every evaluation and adjustment will also happen. Okay, because initial items about the project may be changed also. Okay, so we need to consider those things. Okay, So this is an illustration of the capital budgeting decisions, okay? So basically, there is the idea development. So from the idea development, you are going to collect data, and this will involve accounting, finance, and engineering, because they are going to assign probabilities relating to, or basically estimate the probability of the profitability and the success of the business or the project that is being considered. And then decision making will happen, okay? And then there will be results. After results are taken, you're going to reevaluate, reassign probabilities, and then go back again. So basically, the capital budgeting process will go on until the project is finished. That's why you need to make sure that, to reiterate once again, you need to make sure that you do the process correctly here, because sometimes it is difficult to make adjustments and reassessments after the decision has already been made. Okay? So you need to make sure that you do the collection, the collection of data and the evaluate or the initial evaluation properly. Okay? So next we talk about our accounting flows versus our cash flows. Okay? So the since we are talking about capital budgeting decisions, our focus here is not mainly about the concept of earning profit, but basically the capability of the project to make that profit into cash flows. Okay, so the main guide that we are going to have, or the main item that we're going to consider in our capital budgeting decisions, will be our cash flows. Okay, so we will consider whether our future cash flows will be enough to recover our costs and at the same time earn enough cash flows or profits for our project to be worthwhile. Okay? Our depreciation in for financial statement purposes will be added back to determine the amount of cash that will be generated. Okay, we will show it later on in the next slide. And we need to also take note that emphasis on our analysis will be on the proper evaluation techniques to make best economic choices and assure long-term wealth. Okay, so we need to make sure that the decisions that we're going to do, particularly when you talk about capital budgeting decisions, will be towards the aim of making best choices for long-term wealth generation, because basically that's the goal of financial management. Okay, so this is an example of an analysis so that we can determine our cash flow. So basically, we are going to get first our net income, okay, or earnings before taxes. Basically, that's going to be the main goal. Earnings before taxes less our taxes, we will get the earnings after tax, and then we are going to add back our depreciation. We learned this already in the initial part of our discussion for us to get our cash flow. Okay, so looking into this example, our depreciation will be deducted for purposes of getting our net income or earnings after tax. However, it will be added back because it is not an actual outflow of cash. Okay, because depreciation is a non-cash expense. Okay, and then afterwards, we will get our cash flow. So considering that we are going to have capital budgeting decisions, it will of course involve lots of fixed assets and other depreciable assets, which is going to affect our depreciation. Okay, so it you may consider that depreciation will be a big or a huge amount of expense. However, always remember that this expense is not an actual cash expense, which is not actually going to affect our cash flow. Okay, so considering this example and going to the next one, if assuming you are going to maximize your depreciation in such a way that you are not going to have earnings but you are going to have cash flow, okay, cash flows, then it is still going to be a good project because it is going to avoid taxes. However, it is not going to provide higher cash flows for us. Okay, so comparing the previous one, wherein we have a cash flow of 14,750, and this one, wherein we have a cash flow of 20,000, this is a better outlook, or is a better result, because it may look like you are not earning, Okay? However, in reality, your cash flow is actually increasing. Okay? So we now go to our methods of ranking our investment proposals. So we are going to discuss primarily three items, okay, which we are using in order for us to evaluate our capital budgeting activities, okay? So we have our payback method, we have internal rate of return, and we have net present value, okay? So the payback method, we're going to have an example later on. They consider it to be not sound conceptually. However, it is often used because of its simplicity. The internal rate of return is more acceptable and commonly used. And the net present value is more acceptable and commonly used also. So, actually, we also have profitability index. However, we are not going to discuss that for purposes of this subject. We're only going to discuss these three items. So, let's start first with payback method. So, the payback method is basically going to talk about how many years you are going to recover your investments, okay, based on the cash flows that you are going to receive without considering any without considering any time value of money, okay? So basically, it's like this. If we are going to assume that you are going to earn, or you invested 9 million, let's say for example, or 9,000, assuming that you're going to invest 9,000 in an investment opportunity, and for the first option, for year one alone, you are going to earn the same amount, which means that by year one, there is already 100% payback for your investment, which means that in the succeeding years, everything is already going to be profit. Okay? In option B, okay, wherein there is late returns, in order for you to recover your 9,000 investment, it will take you practically 2 years. Okay? 2 years before you are going to recover your investment. So which means that there is a faster payback period for option A as compared to option B. Okay, so that's basically how payback method is applied. You simply determine how many years it will take before you can recover your investments. So another example is going to be like this, okay? So assuming you're going to have a 10,000 investment, okay? And this will be the cash flows that you're going to receive, okay? So considering that in investment opportunity A, you will basically recover the investment already in 2 years, because that's basically 5,000 plus 5,000, so that's already 10,000. So you already recovered it in 2 years. However, for investment B, it will take you, let's try to compute that, let's bring out our calculator. So basically, to recover your 10,000, it will take you 15 for the first year, minus 2,000 for the second year, minus 25 for the third year, minus 5, sorry. So basically, that's only 4,000 in year 4. So basically, it's going to be 3.8. Okay, 3.8 years before you can recover. Because basically, in year 4, you're only going to recover 4,000 out of 5,000. Okay, so if that is 4,000, sorry. If that is 4,000, because you are going to recover the remaining 4,000 out of 5,000 in year 4, that's 0.8. So meaning, before you can recover the 10,000, it will take you 3.8 years. Okay, so 3.8 years before you can recover the investment as compared to investment A, which is going to be recoverable in 2 years. Okay? So basically, if you're going to use your payback method or payback period method, you will accept investment A rather than investment B, because investment A has a faster payback period. So for payback period, the shorter the better. Okay, so that's basically the decision guide there. Okay, so the advantage of Payback method is that it is easy to understand and it emphasizes liquidity because basically it's just going to talk about your cash flows. Okay? In order for you to qualify in or in order for the project to qualify in under the payback method, you need to make sure that you recover the investment faster. Okay? Rapid payback is preferred in industries characterized by dynamic technological developments. That's why some businesses usually use also payback method because they wanted to look for business opportunities that will have a faster recovery of capital so that they can earn faster also. Okay? However, there are also shortcomings or disadvantages in using your payback method because payback method does not consider time value of money or present value. That makes the decision somewhat lacking because we need to consider that the cash flows will be generated in the future and therefore we need to subject that to present value for us to get the actual amount that we're going to receive. Okay, considering the present values. Okay, that's why we also have another approach which is known as your internal rate of return. Okay, so the internal rate of return is going to is basically used in order for us to determine the it's basically pertaining to the interest rate or pertaining to the discount rate or profitability rate that is going to be earned in a particular business setup or in a particular decision. So as an example, assuming that you're going to invest $1,000 and the return is $2,244 per year, okay, for 5 years, okay. And we are going to determine what will be the internal rate of return. So this is similar to what you are doing in financial accounting, wherein you are going to get the discount rate or you are going to get the earnings percentage based on the cash flows provided. Okay, so in this case, using the formula that we learned in cost of capital, if we are going to determine the present value factor, then the investment will be divided by the annuity and we will get 4.1. So what we are going to do is to look for a present value that is going to be or a discount rate that is going to be equivalent to 4.1. Okay, so it says there that this is 7%. However, in our activities, the 7% is not going to be given. So what are we going to do? We will bring out our calculator again. Okay, let's bring out our calculator and let's try to determine if that is 7% actually. So we are going to try. So we are going to have 1.07. So what we are going to do is to compute the present value ordinary annuity, okay, for 5 years using 7%. So let's try 1.07, then divide, enter, and then 5 years, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, and then put that to memory. 1 minus memory recall, okay, and then divided by 0.07, so that's 4.10. So basically it's the same here. So what you're going to do in your activities later on is you're going to have trial and error. Okay, so based on this information, okay, if we can get this present value factor using 7% in computing our present value ordinary annuity, then it means that 7% is really correct. So the rate of return for this investment is 7%. Now, what is going to be the relevance of the internal rate of return? Now, okay, before we go here, let's go back first to the previous slide. Okay, that's just an example. So what's the relevance of 7% now? Okay, so if your cost of capital is 10% and the internal rate of return that you computed is only 7%, does that mean that our project is worthwhile? The answer is no. Why? Because your cost of capital is 10%. Your potential earnings is only 7%. So it's not going to be a good business decision to pursue that project or this project because it is not going to earn enough to recover our cost of capital. Okay, that's why we discussed first our cost of capital before we had this discussion because we need to understand the relationship between cost of capital and our returns. Okay, so going back, if the return in this example is 7%, and according to additional information, the cost of capital is, let's say, 9%. Okay? Still, the answer is this project should not be pursued because it is less or it is going to result in a negative 2% return. Okay? However, if let's say, for example, your cost of capital is only 5% and this will result to 7% return, then it's a good decision because you will still have an extra 2% earnings. Okay, so that's basically how it works. So let's have this example. Okay, so assuming that we have a 10,000 investment and this will be our earnings, okay, under investment opportunity A and investment opportunity B. Okay, so first, in order for us to determine the value of our internal rate of return, let us first do this. Okay, so under investment A, what we are going to do is determine the average earnings through the entire 5 years. So in this case, if we're going to have 5 + 5 + 2, that's going to be 12 divided by 3 because we're going to have only 3 years under investment A. So the average is 4,000. What we're going to do next is we are going to divide the investment by 4,000, which is the average earnings. Okay, this is just an estimate. Okay, so the first approximation, okay, we are going to determine then what is going to be a discount rate or a present value that's going to result to 2.5. Okay, so what you're going to do now is to determine a discount rate that has 2.5 as the present value factor and period of 3. Okay, so using the estimation, that is actually between 9% or 10%. Okay, if we're going to do the same with investment B, okay, so let's just wait. Before we proceed, let us confirm if this is correct. Okay, so we need to try to determine if 2.5 is actually possible. Okay, so let's try. If we're going to use 9%, that's 1.09. Divide, enter, and then 3 periods, so 1, 2, 3. Okay, and then, I forgot to clear the memory. Okay, memory plus, okay, and then 1 minus memory recall. Okay, then divide this by 0.09. So that's 2.53. So basically, it's near that already. So our internal rate of return is around 9%. Okay, so around between 9 to 10%, so around 9.5, just to make it simpler. Okay, let's do the same for investment opportunity B. Okay, let's do the same. Let's go back to the previous slide. Let's do this. Okay, so let's bring out our calculator. And what we're going to do first is to get all the total here. So that's 1,500 plus 2,000 plus 2,500 plus 5,000 plus 5,000. Okay, then divide this by 5. So it's going to have 3,200. Okay, so we are going to divide 10,000 by 3,200 and we're going to get 3.125. So what we are going to do is to determine a discount rate over 5 years that will result in 3.125. So let's start first with, let's say, five percent maybe. So let's just try. So 5%, and then that's going to be 5 years. So take note, our goal is to get 3.125. So let's have 1.05, divide, enter, and then 5 years, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, 1 minus, I forgot to put that to memory. Okay, again. 1.05, divide, enter, and then 5 years, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay, M plus, 1 minus memory recall divided by 0.05. Okay, so that's not the answer because that's 4.3. We're only looking for 3.125. Okay, so let's go higher because if we're going to have a higher discount rate, we're going to have a lower present value. So let's try 1.8%, 1.08, divide, enter, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so let's try. Memory plus, I forgot to clear. Memory plus 1 minus memory recall. Okay, divided by 0.08. So that's 3.99. So we're still going to go higher. So let's try 9% also. So clear first. Okay, so 1.09 divide, enter. And then 5 periods, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, and then memory plus 1 minus memory recall divided by 0.09. So that's 3.88. So still, we're going to need to go higher once more. So let's have 10%. 1.1 divide, enter. Then 5 periods, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so memory plus 1 minus the previous answer. Then divided by 0.1. It's going to be 3.79. So we are getting close, but basically we still need to get 3.125. So let's try around 11%. So let's clear first. So this will really take lots of trial and error considering that we do not have the same cash flows. Okay, so 1.11 divide, enter, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, memory plus 1 minus the previous answer, then divided by 0.11. So we're getting here, but basically we need to go a bit higher. So we will see, let's say maybe 13%. Let's just jump in increments of 2%. So let's have 1.13. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, then memory plus 1 minus memory recall, then divided by 0.13. Still, this is higher. So most probably the present value that we're looking for is around maybe 15% or more. Okay, so anyway, let's try to see. So according to the discussion, averaging understates actual IRR, same method would overstate IRR for investment B. Okay, so cash flows in early years are worth more and increase the return. Okay, so possible to gauge whether first approximation is overstated or understated. Okay, so what we are going to do is to have another method. Okay, so using trial and error, what we are going to do is to use the actual cash flows. Okay, use the actual cash flows and then from there start trial and error. Okay, so in this case, if we are going to start with 10% for investment A and 12% in investment B. Okay, so again, you need to have a starting point. Okay, so what I do, okay, what I do so that I can have a basis is going to be like this. Okay, so I'll just guide you. Let's just go back to our cash flows there. Where is that? Here, okay. So if let's say for example we have this now, so I'll just show you. Okay, so we have just an estimate. So let's have our calculator. So if this is going to be 12,000, okay, and then I am going to invest 10,000, then it means that I am going to earn 2,000. However, based on the ratio of the cash flows, the ratio for the first cash flow will be 5 over the total of 12,000. So I will multiply this by 5 divided by 12, and this will be my earning in the first year. So if this is going to be my earnings in the first year, then I will divide this by 10,000. And my starting point will be around 8%. So I can do that. I can start with 8% and then I'm going to go up. Okay, so that's my starting point. If we're going to have this, okay, so the total that I'm going to have here will be 15 plus 2,000 plus 25 plus 5,000 plus 5,000. This is going to be 16,000. So with an investment of 10,000, I have 6,000 earnings here. If I'm going to determine how much is my earnings, okay, for or how much I'm going to have, okay, then I am going to simply allocate this by the amount of outstanding principal, okay? So what I'm going to do here will be, since I'm going to have the first year, so the total outstanding here is, I still have 10,000 there, okay? So that's going to be, let's just allocate that. So my earnings there will be equal to 6,000 times 15 divided by 16,000. Oops, okay. Let's divide this by 10,000. 5%. Okay. So from there, let us allocate. Okay, so anyway, using trial and error, you will see that under this particular investment opportunity, investment A, since the present value using 10% is already around this is already around 10,177, so it's near already, so it's near 10%, so we can simply say that it is around 10%. So the discount rate or the internal rate of return is around 10%. For investment B, or so for the same investment, using 12%, that's already 9.874. So with that, we are going to get the middle, okay, and get the discount rate, okay? So at 12%, the present value of the inflow is less than 10,000. Thus, the discount rate is too high already. Meaning, we're going to get the discount rate between 10 to 12%. So using interpolation, okay, so if the difference, okay, we're going to get the difference between 10% and 12%, and we're going to get the difference between either the higher or the lower amount, okay, this is going to be 177, so we'll divide it. Okay, so this is the same as what we do in financial accounting. So there is a 2% difference. Okay, so this is going to be 177 divided by 3.3. Okay, so meaning the discount rate is going to be this one. Okay, so let's just continue with the computation there. So it's going to be 10% plus a fraction of the difference between 10% and 12%, so that's 2%. So that's going to be basically 10% plus 1.17%. Okay, so if you do the multiplication here, that's already this one. So the internal rate of return, therefore, in this project is 11.17. Okay, so to do the same, if we're going to do the same in project B or investment B, your internal rate of return will be 14.33. Okay, so in that case, which is better? Is it is a return of 11.17 better than 14.33? Of course, the answer is no. It is better if your interest or internal rate of return is higher. Okay, so if you're given a choice, which is better? Is it better or is investment A, or which is better, investment A or investment B? The answer is investment B, because it has a higher internal rate of return. Okay, so that's basically how you do it. So there, so that is our example. Okay. So if we do the interpolation, okay, and if we try to analyze now, it's like this. If we are going to analyze the opportunities or the business opportunities using the payback method, our answer is investment A because it has a faster payback. If we're going to use internal rate of return, our answer will be choose investment B because it has a higher yield. Okay, so that will be your investment, or that will be your decision depending on the method that you're going to use. Okay. Next, we can use also the net present value. Okay. So the net present value method is basically giving you an idea of how much is going to be left with the business after getting the present value of the cash flows. Okay, so that's basically how it works. So do the same. Okay, so assuming that you invested 10% and the discount rate of the project is 10%. Okay, so what you're going to do is to get the present value of the cash flows, okay, using the same 10%. So we're going to have the same computation all throughout, but of course for investment B, there is a cash flow until year 5. So what you're going to do is to get the total of the present values of your investments. Okay, so investment A has a total present value of 10,177, while investment B has a present value of 11,414. Okay, so what's the result? The investment under investment B is higher, okay, or the net present value. Okay, because if you're going to choose investment A, you are only going to earn 177 in total. If you're going to go for investment B, your net present value earnings is going to be 1,414, which is better. Okay, so in this case, if you're going to use net present value, your answer will be investment B because it is going to yield a higher net present value. Okay, so most of the time, that your answer under IRR or your investment decision under IRR is also going to be the same under net present value. Okay, so to sum it up, is going to be like this. Under payback method, internal rate of return, and net present value, okay, if you're going to make a decision between investment A and investment B using payback method, you're going to choose investment A because it has a faster payback. If we're going to use internal rate of return, we will choose investment B because it has a higher yield. And if we're going to use net present value, we are going to choose investment B because it has a higher net present value, meaning we're going to have a higher net cash flow later on. Okay, so that's basically your decision guide. Okay, so your selection strategy will be dependent on whether the investment opportunities are mutually exclusive or not mutually exclusive. Okay, so what do we mean by mutually exclusive? Okay, it simply means that if you already chose one alternative, you cannot choose the other alternatives anymore. While if we say that the projects are not mutually exclusive, it means that you can choose any alternatives that has a return that is higher than the cost of capital. So that's basically our decision guide. So again, to repeat, if the projects are mutually exclusive, what we are going to choose will be the best alternative. Okay, selection of one alternative will preclude selection of the other alternatives, which means that we will only choose one. So meaning we're going to choose the best alternative if the projects are mutually exclusive. However, if the projects are not mutually exclusive, then what we are going to do is to choose all projects that has a cost or that has a return that is higher or in excess of the cost of our capital. So that's our decision guide there. Okay? So considering this example, okay, assuming we have this particular projects, okay? So we have projects that has an IRR and net present value as follows. Okay, so in the case of the prior investments A and B, assuming that a capital of 10%, meaning this is our cost of capital, Investment B would be accepted if the alternatives were mutually exclusive, while both would clearly qualify if they were not mutually exclusive. Why? Because it's like this. If the project is mutually exclusive, we will choose the best. Okay? So which is the best or which is better under investment A and investment B? The answer is investment B, because it is going to provide you with higher yield and higher net present value. However, if you are going to consider that both investments are not mutually exclusive, if the cost of capital is 10%, our investment A has a yield of 11.17 and investment B has 14.33, which is still higher than 10%. Therefore, our decision guide is, our decision for the project, if it is not mutually exclusive, is to accept both projects because it is still, or their returns are higher than our cost of capital, which is 10%. Okay? So that's basically how you do the decisions. Okay. So what will be our assumptions here? So internal rate of return and net present value will call for the same decision. Just like what we said a while ago, they will give you the same decision or the same conclusion if we're going to use internal rate of return and net present value. Okay? Exceptions to this generally common scenario will be if both methods will accept or reject the same investments and the two methods may give different answers in selecting the best investment from a range of acceptable alternatives. Okay, meaning if the projects are mutually exclusive, then they will give you the same decision. If the projects are not mutually exclusive, okay, there will be exceptions which are pertaining to these items here. Okay? So that's basically the main concept there. So again, your decisions will be dependent on the computations that you made. Okay. Before we move on, this will be the first part and this will be our the end of the discussion first. Afterwards, we're going to proceed with the next one.